Hey guys, welcome back to another video on diagnosing some issues with my Pentair automation system, this EasyTouch automation system I have here. So on my last video on this, I was trying to fix the RS-485 communications, which I lost about a year and a half ago between my pump, the control board, and my wireless Green Logic app. So I fixed that last time replacing a chip that was bad. So if you haven't seen that video, go check out that video on that diagnosis. Once I got that all back and running, I noticed my auxiliary relays and my heater signal wasn't working correctly. So today we're gonna be diagnosing that and I'll show you what I discovered on my diagnosis. So here on this EasyTouch Lite, which is the one I have, the difference between the EasyTouch Lite, and the EasyTouch 8 is the number of auxiliary outputs and inputs you have. So the Lite one only has 4 and also has very minimal features versus the regular EasyTouch. This system was installed in 2019 and it was a very basic system. So recently when I got this thing back working again, I noticed my auxiliary 3 was always hot. So when I pressed the button, it wouldn't do anything because the relay was always energized. And that was kind of weird because usually the relays only energize when you press it and turn it on. And then I noticed it wasn't sending the closed signal for the dry contact for my heater. So today I'll show you what I diagnosed and figured out on this thing. So once you get to the back of the board here, you'll notice all your auxiliary inputs and outputs right here on this spot, which triggers actual relays down here. There's like 4 relays down here on most boxes. So those are right here. Then you have your other contacts here, and then you have your valve controls over here. So the valve controls actually send 24 volts either direction to the valves to open and close. This thing just sends voltage to the relay. I think it's 24 volts AC right here for the auxiliary and the pumps. So those, for this particular one, we only use 4 of the 8 that are here. So it has like 8 total because they probably share these boards with the other versions. They just have limited programming depending on what you pay for, but all the hardware is actually here and all the chips on here are actually in there too. So you have to unbolt this board right here to see what's on the other side to do the diagnosis. The rest of the inputs and outputs on here are as follows. Over here is your RS-485 communications. So right now, actually on my last video, I put a surge protector here to help protect that chip, but you have control to your pump. Then you have the 4 wires that come out of here that also go up here to the wireless that I have for the wireless control and the Screen Logic control. Here you have the IS4 remote. So this remote input is for if you have a spa and you have one of the buttons next to the spa, it's a wired communications link so you can turn the spa on and off. Over here you have your 3 sensors. You have your water sensor, you have your solar, and then you have your air sensor, all 3 of which I use here. This one is the last one, which is the heater output. So this is just a dry contact that closes when the heater's on and opens when you turn off the heater. And it just goes back to the master temp 400 heater that we have over here into the fireman's switch, which opens and closes to turn that thing on and off. So this thing right now is also not communicating. And I kind of discovered it all went back to the same chip that's causing the problems with my auxiliary 3. So one of the things I noticed, my auxiliary 3, which I'm not even using right now, is just going to a blank relay. It would be always be on after I fixed everything, right? So I can hear it click when I plug it in. So you can hear the relay clicking. So it's clicking on. When I pull it off, it turns off. So I found that was weird because that's not supposed to do that. That means every time this is on here, it's just holding that. And then when I push the input for the auxiliary 3, you can see the light come on and off, but it's not doing anything. It's not switching the relay. So that was very odd too. So that's when I decided to start opening things up and trying to figure out what was wrong. So to undo this board, there's actually 9 screws all around the board that hold it to there. Then you can just flip it over. So right now we've got it flipped over and you can see this board, like I explained earlier, it's being used between all the different models. They just have different programming. So it's actually got all the auxiliaries over here that it doesn't have the physical buttons on here. And they actually do still have the buttons back here on the actual molding itself. It's just not being used as far as actually having a button that you could press. So you could just press the blanks here and you'll actually press buttons back here that don't do anything. So anyways, on that RS-485 chip I replaced, it was underneath that screen on my last video where I had to desolder all this. So as I was doing the diagnosis, I started tracking all the outputs right here at the bottom of the board, which go out to my relays. So I started tracing all those back to the chip, and I discovered that these two chips right here, they're ULN2803s. What they are they're 8 output transistors. So they're using the transistors to switch the relays, right? So from the low voltage signal onto the kind of a higher voltage 24 volts to these actual outputs right here. And I discovered that this chip right here, which is mapped to all the pins that are having issues, and it's also mapped to the heater pin on the very end that I had. So the two heaters on here, if you look on the back, you have a heater which is for the electronic heater right here, and you have the heater for the gas heater over here. They actually have one shared pin between those two, and they all lead back to this transistor right here. So I noticed that all 8 of the outputs on here on this transistors were having the issues that I was seeing on here. So earlier when I was mentioning that relay where it was clicking, so every one of the relays that are not being used, they're all clicking that output, so they're all hot right now. So what that suggests to me is that something's wrong with that chip. So both these chips, there's 16 inputs and outputs being used on this board right now. So these two chips right here control all of those. So I noticed that all these pins, I marked them black on here just to know, were having issues, and they were all linked back to a pin that was having issues on the physical board. And then I noticed this one was the same exact chip. So what I did was I actually swapped the two chips, and the problem followed. So all the same problems I was having on these outputs, or these auxiliary outputs right here, when I swapped the chips, I was having the same outputs on my pull pump, my light, and my blower. So when I swapped the chips, my blower came on, my lights came on, and then it sent power to my pump. So that suggests to me that there was an issue with these chips. So what I did was I just went online and ordered a new set of chips. I ordered 10 of them for like $8 or something on Amazon. These are like $2 each if you buy them from Jameco, but the shipping after you buy 2 or 4 of these, plus the shipping from Jameco, DigiKey, or any of the online electronic sellers, is gonna be more than those 10 that I ordered on Amazon. So I just ordered the 10 on Amazon, they came the next day, and I have them right now, and I'm gonna go ahead and swap both of them out, and I'm gonna see if the problem follows. So for the diagnosis, like earlier I said, I was doing a continuity test, so I just took my multimeter, I set it to continuity. So when there's continuity, it just beeps. So I found that those outputs, right? So on that one was 1, 2, 3. So the third one right here was, which is auxiliary 3, I was having problems with, and I could see the trace right there on the board. It actually just goes right here all the way to that trace. So I just touched that pin to here, and it was the same, I could hear it beep, right? So I went to the next pin, and you can see that pin is mounted, is going straight to this pot right here, which goes underneath the trace on the next one. So I chose the next pin. So that one beeps. The third one is right here, that one's obvious. And then the rest of them go to other outputs and inputs on here that aren't being used on the backside. So there's these 4 right here that aren't being used, so there was no, there was nothing that suggests that. The heater one was the one that I was really concerned about, because that was the only function that I'm losing right now, other than that auxiliary that I'm not using. So that one, so I measured it was to that same pin right here, so it was beeping. So right there, I kind of nailed it down to this chip was causing my problem. So right here are the replacement chips I bought on Amazon. So they are the 2803s, which all the LN2803s are basically all the same. This one is an APG. So A is the same as the one that I'm taking out. The one I'm taking out is a ULN2803A. This is also a ULN2803APG. So the P is the plastic and G is the green manufacturing. So this is a newer chip, so it's got the green manufacturing. And these are Toshiba chips that I have right here. So what I already did is I turned off all the power at the breaker to all the electronics so I don't fry anything. I'm gonna go ahead and take my chip puller right here. If you don't have a chip puller, you could probably just use some pliers or something to just kind of wiggle it out. So this thing's in a socket, so it makes it easier. So what I'm gonna do is just kind of just pull it straight out. So I'll pull it straight out right here, take the old one out, put the new one in the same orientation. So you'll see a little notch on the actual socket and the notch over here. So this one follows the same notch. So you wanna just go ahead and just line up the holes in there and just push these things in and snap it into all the holes. Like I said earlier, just because I've had so much surge problems on this board and my pull system, I'm gonna go ahead and just replace the one that's not having issues also. This one is an ST brand that's coming OEM, so I'm gonna just replace both of them with the Toshibas. So again, same procedure, just make sure all your pins are straight. Some of them might be crooked from shipping or from just handling. Kind of line them all into the holes and push them through. So I finally popped everything back in. Looks like it's in pretty good there. Go ahead and turn the power back on. All right, let's set for a second. So right now my third output is working. My air is working. I'm gonna go ahead and turn the pool pump on. Air pump. I'm gonna switch my valve and see if my heater signal comes on. So right now I'm changing it to spa. It's turning on the heater. We'll go over there and see if the heater input is coming on. So right now the heater circuit's energized, so it's sending the signal to the heater. So this is exactly what I needed to do. So everything looks like it's working now with that simple fix with that $2 chip. So back over here again, we'll go ahead and turn off the spa. I just shut the heater off over there. I'll let the valves all close back up again. But the light circuit works. This works. The rest of these are disabled, so even the buttons, it's disabled in programming, so even if, when we press the buttons, none of the auxiliaries work on here. They sell you the light version, but what they're selling you is software. The hardware is all the same. So all the valves have switched back, so I'm gonna go ahead and turn the pump off. So that's turning off right there. Go ahead and turn the lights off, so the lights go off. So now that we've got everything fixed, I'm gonna button it all back up. Got everything back together here. All these power surges I've had in my area have wreaked havoc on my pool equipment. That's what's been taking all this stuff out. In addition, I've lost a router and a switch from my internet inside the house from the same lightning strikes or surges. So I highly recommend putting the house or at least your panel on like a surge protector. I'll actually have a video coming up where I'm gonna install a whole house surge protector, which will help with some of this surge I'm having around the house. And I might get some additional surge protectors for these lower panels. They're still like $50 to $100 for each one of these surge protectors, but they're a lot cheaper than having to replace a $1,000 board like this. Hey guys, thanks for joining me on this quick video on fixing that problem with my auxiliaries and all my signals coming out of this Pentair EasyTouch. As you can see, all it takes is a little bit of diagnosis and just fixing and understanding how this system works. This is a very rudimentary, basic system. It's like 1980s technology that they charge an arm and a leg for. If you're having similar problems and you can't resolve this issue with your board or whatever, I would highly recommend that you just scrap this EasyTouch or IntelliTouch or whatever you have if you don't already have screen logic and just upgrade to the new IntelliCenter. The new IntelliCenter, actually, there's a kit that retrofits just this whole bucket up top here. All your relays and inputs and everything are still gonna be the same, but it all plugs into the same thing because they're all the same connectors. So you just replace the whole bucket and you get the new one. Comes with Wi-Fi, it comes with all the new programming, all the new apps and all the new controls and scheduling. And it's only like $800 to $1,000 and it's a very simple DIY. There's actually some videos that I saw online that show you how to do it. I'll link it down in the description if you need to see that. But those videos will help you retrofit it without the use of a contractor. So that's another option you have if you can't diagnose it and fix it as easily as I can. Anyways, if you guys found this video useful, give it a thumbs up. If you haven't subscribed to my channel to stay on top of different house DIY, car DIY, or whatever I'm doing, go ahead and subscribe to your channel. Remember guys, if I can do it, you guys can do it. I want to thank you for watching and I'll talk to you guys next time.